Welcome to another edition of Critical Insight on Your World News. And once again, back-to-back shows, we are in collaboration with the Nimburu Media Collective at the Nimburu Cultural Center on the campus of the University of Maryland. And again, a familiar guest that we have, Brother Maurice Carney, who is Executive Director of Friends of the Congo. It's great to have you back on. And it's also great to have on for the first time, Brother Kito, who also is a member of Friends of the Congo. Thank both of you for coming on to discuss this important topic, you know, talking about the Congo and its importance to not just to African people, but people worldwide, especially people that care about humanity and want to further discuss the Congo Week and its importance in terms of raising the specter of consciousness globally about Congo. And, you know, really that's part and parcel. Without doing that, it's hard to realistically see the change that we all want to see in the Congo, you know, without raising the specter of consciousness. And so without further ado, thank you for coming on. And I'll start with you, Maurice Carney. Wanted to ask you, why should people care about the Congo? Why should people care about the Congo? And we can start with since we're talking about the Congo Week, why should Black students care about the Congo? I mean, we're situated in the Black Cultural Center right now at the University of Maryland. Mm-hmm. Why should Black students and then writ large, like Black people in general, care about the Congo?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Solomon, for having us on. And thank you for that question. That just gets right to the heart of the matter. And there really a host of reasons why Africans, Black folks in particular, should care about the Congo. If you, Solomon, if you take the last 500 years of our tragic history, the tragic part of our history, described by our wonderful sister, Marimba Ani, as the Mahafa, right? At the beginning of the Mahafa, at the outset of the Mahafa, Congo, the heart of the African continent, loomed large. Mm-hmm. According to Emory University slavery database on its slavevoyages.org website and UNESCO as well, mm-hmm. almost half of the Africans that were trafficked from the continent by Europeans came out of the Congo region, right? 4 out of 10 to be specific. So what we've observed over the 500 years, at certain critical junctures, particularly when we talk about European incursion mm-hmm. and African space, Congo has paid the dearest price. Mm-hmm. At the start of the trafficking of Africans, 4 out of 10 came out of Congo region. That process of plunder and extraction in the interest of the advancement of capitalism continued. You know, if we're talking about from the late 1400s, 400 years or so later, mm-hmm. 1884, 1885, the Berlin Conference, when Europe, after exploiting human resource of the African continent, and they sought to exploit the natural resource of the African continent by carving up the continent, establishing spheres of influence, and Congo was the biggest prize, that grand cake that King Leopold II of Belgium talked about. And that was given to him, the Congo, where he ruled for a 23-year period from 1885 to 1908. And there we saw again Congo paying the dearest price. And that's half the population was decimated in that period, where the king extracted rubber to feed the capitalist system in the West. And we saw that an estimated 10 million people perished under the reign of King Leopold. I'll fast forward to today, from 1996 to the present, an estimated 6 million Congolese have perished as minerals such as coltan and cobalt extracted from the Congo in order to feed the capitalist system, the advancement of technology, our cell phones and batteries in our laptops and our electric vehicles. Mm-hmm. So from 1480s right up to today, we see that as it relates to the tragedy that we face as an African family, Congo's paid the dearest price. That alone should make Congo matter to each and every one of us. It's in the heart of the African continent. It's been targeted, whether intentionally or not, it's been targeted in a way that has had a devastating impact on the continent. What that has done, Salman, is not only served to depopulate and set back the continent, but it has blocked the advancement and liberation of Africa. And that's why in the post-independence period, in the late 50s, early 60s, when our most ardent revolutionaries gathered, and I'm talking about the likes of Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, Sekou Touré, mm-hmm. you know, of Guinea, Modibo Keita yes. of Mali, when they gathered to form and establish the Pan-African Project, the United States of Africa, they saw Congo as central to that. And they not only sent support to Lumumba so that he can liberate the Congo, but in their Pan-African Project, in the forward-looking project, they saw Congo serving as the capital of the United States of Africa because of its strategic location in the heart of the African continent, because of its spectacular wealth, arguably the richest country in the world in terms of natural resources, because of the incredible potential as it relates to energy, as the hydro capacity to electrify, provide electricity for the whole continent, even Southern Europe and West Asia, has the agricultural capacity, if fully realized, Solomon, to feed the African continent almost twice over. They have that agricultural capacity to feed 2 billion people. So our revolutionaries saw that this was central and crucial for the Pan-African Project and a free and liberated Africa. So they're in essence saying there is no free and liberated Africa yeah. without a free and liberated Congo. And Nkrumah even laid this out in a book called The Challenge of the Congo. So if you're concerned about Black life and the tragedy that we've faced as a people, Congo should be front and center for you. If you're concerned about the liberation of our people, Congo should be front and center for you. You know, as Fanon said in his book, Toward an African World Revolution, that the fate of all of us is at stake in the Congo. And he said, let us never forget that. So these are the reasons in particular why Congo matters. If you are concerned about Black liberation, you cannot be concerned about Black liberation without being concerned about the Congo. Irrespective of where you are in the world. And Malcolm X said it well in one of the meetings, the initial meetings of the Organization of African Unity, Afro-American Unity in 1964. He was showing a film on the Congo, talking about the Congo, and somebody in the audience asked that same question. Man, we catching hell right here in Harlem. Why are we dealing with the Congo, Malcolm? You know, and he said, Malcolm responded in the way that he does is, well, I want to respond to this brother who was talking out the side of his mouth. Yeah. And he said, as long as you think you got to get Mississippi straight, mm-hmm. before you get the Congo straight, you will never get Mississippi straight. Mm-hmm. So that's why Congo matters. If you're about Black liberation, then you got to be about the Congo. If you're about in free and liberated Africa, free and liberated Black people throughout the globe, you got to be engaged in the Congo.
I appreciate that. And Brother Kito, I have a question for you. But before I ask you that question, Brother Kito, Maurice, if you could briefly follow up for folks that are watching right now, because, you know, I appreciate you giving that historical context. And then the more nefarious side, you know, we're talking about the Congo has, as you laid out, has all these vital mineral resources, cobalt, coltan, uranium, I mean, everything. We know that rubber, I mean, you know, that's what Leopold, you know, the devil and his henchmen came in and mutilated, chopped the hands off of everyone from young boys to older men to try to, you know, to try to get access to more and more of the rubber that's in the Congo. But we look at the uranium, and since we are situated right now within the manufactured boards of the United States, the role the United States played, right, with Patrice Lumumba's demise. As you said, at one time, Malcolm X called him the greatest living African, you know, on the planet. This man was brutally assassinated. Can you talk about that in the context? Because from my understanding, the vast majority of uranium that was used even to mercilessly bomb, you know, the Japanese after the emperor had already capitulated and surrendered, and Truman wanted to make sure that he bombed them not once, but bombed them twice, only country ever to use a nuclear weapon. But the majority of that came out of the Congo. And was it because Lumumba said no longer are the people, you know, going to, you know, basically the paraphrase of the Congo going to be the second or the tertiary folks to benefit from their own natural resources? What role has the United States played in this?
Oh, wow. Well, I mean, the United States has been engaged in the Congo right from the very beginning in terms of the modern Congo, 1884, 1885. They were the first country in the world to recognize the ownership of Congo under King Leopold II, you know, Belgium. And to give some perspective, when Haiti fought and got its freedom, the U.S. took some 66 decades to recognize Haiti as a state. But not only that, what you see with the Congo, Solomon, when there are advances, technological advances made in the West, some resource has to come out of the Congo to fuel those advances, whether it's the rubber, late 1800s for the and early 1900s for the automobile industry, the uranium that was used for the Manhattan Project and atomic weapons that were dropped on Japan, or even right up to today, the coltan for our cell phones or the cobalt for our electric vehicles. We see that technological advances depending on the resources in Congo. Your listening audience probably familiar with the film Oppenheimer, which documents the Manhattan Project and the United States racing to develop the atomic weapons. Well, it couldn't have happened without the uranium from the Congo. Shinkobole is in the Katanga province, is the mine where the uranium was extracted from the Congo and shipped to New York to be a part of the to facilitate the development of the atomic weapons. There are uranium that did come from Canada, but the overwhelming majority came from the Congo, and the highest quality, which is really important, came from the Congo. So you probably won't get that story Oppenheimer film, but that's the underbelly of that Oppenheimer story, that the natural resources that facilitated this dastardly weapon that we used to annihilate the Japanese population came out of the Congo region. And the fact that Patrice Lumumba wanted to, when he became prime minister, maintain all these resources for the benefit of Congolese, that spurred the U.S. into action. According to U.S.'s own documents, the declassified documents, State Department declassified their documents around that era in the early 1960s. They looked at covert action of the United States from 1960 to 1967. And they said it was the State Department says the largest covert action in the world at the time in terms of financing. That covert action that led to the overthrow and subsequent assassination of Patrice Lumumba. That was the biggest on the part of the United States, because not only because Lumumba wanted those resources for the benefit of Congolese, but what Larry Devlin, the chief of station of the Congo, in his book, Chief of Station Congo, said, we had to overthrow Lumumba. That's what he said, Solomon. Because if we didn't overthrow Lumumba, not only would we have lost Congo, but we would have lost all of Africa. That is to say that you have a self-determined, self-governing, independent state in the heart of the African continent. He's saying that it's over for us.
Yeah. You're on mute by accident.
Waves of liberation throughout the entire African continent.
Thank you. I
and that, And that's why you had Keita and Nkrumah and Toure. They knew that. They were clear. That's the thing about Congo. Both Congo's friends and enemies are clear about the centrality and the significance.
Right on, right on. I really appreciate that. And I hope folks are watching right now, because that's so important. And that's, you know, we're only talking about the 60s, right? We're only talking about the early 60s. So it's not super long ago. But then looking at the context, we see a lot of the cycle of that of United States interference. And I'm putting it lightly. I'm euphemizing, you know. But United States interference in other countries' affairs, and we see the coups have not stopped. I mean, we just go back to Manuel Zelaya in Honduras, and there's way
too many
lists. So I appreciate that. Yeah,
absolutely,
brother Kito. You're a member of Friends of the Congo. Why did you feel compelled to join with the other members, such as Maurice Carney, and there's a lot of members worldwide that are part of Friends of the Congo? I mean, I was, you know, just doing a simple internet search, and I saw all these different images of people throughout the globe who have supported the Congo Week years past, and certainly, this year is not going to be any different. But why was it important for you to join Friends of the Congo and get involved?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Brother Solomon, for having me on and having us on and putting this information out there. But so I was introduced to the Congo in a political sense when I was right down the street from you and studying in Annapolis. I was a student at the United States Naval Academy. Mm. And I was reading the final speeches of Malcolm X my junior year. And I was reading about what he was saying about Patrice Lumumba, the Congo, and also at that same time, we were learning courses on what they called insurgencies, which turned out to be revolutionary groups throughout the globe that were fighting colonialism and neocolonialism. So that's where I was introduced to it. And at that point, when I was going on a direction to serve this country, I realized that I was on the wrong side. The more in depth I went into learning about the Congo, the more it set me, who I feel me straight, because it allowed me to see, you know, how to make the next move, my best move for my family, my community, and my ancestors, you know. So that's personally, that's where the Congo became important to me. As I grew and got into business, I learned of Maurice through a mutual friend, mutual activist, and because I wanted to work with people over there in business, but I also didn't want to exploit, you know, anybody, the nation, the people, and all that. So, you know, just learning, like I said, just learning the how much the United States has been invested in the Congo, in destroying the Congo politically, and taking the resources, and then learning the effects today of you know, the over mining of what's going on there, the displacement of the people, and like Malcolm said, Maurice just said, it doesn't matter. Everything you do over here matters, and a lot of it affects our brothers and sisters over there. If you're not making the right decisions, you could be impacting them in a negative way.
That's right.
Just when you think about it, this green energy, this electric cars, all that has a detrimental impact to the land in the Congo, to the people in the Congo. So, you know, we have to educate ourselves. We have to educate ourselves. We have to educate ourselves. And Congo Week is just that. It allows the average person to get a clear understanding of what's really taking place. So when we're faced with who to elect and why to elect them, or what direction to move in, you know, we have the knowledge to do so, and keep our family and generations of our brothers and sisters over there in mind. That makes sense.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. It makes a lot of sense. I appreciate it. Thank you. Maurice, you know, you've been with Friends of the Congo, I believe, since its inception. So, you know, Brother Kito, you know, articulated and just beautifully laid out, you know, very, very like strong reasons why, you know, he felt compelled to get involved with Friends of the Congo, and then Congo Week is an initiative that comes out of Friends of the Congo. I wanted to ask you, just since you've been around since day one, why did y'all start Friends of the Congo in the first place, and what kind of track record does it have? Like what is the reach? Where has it gone? I believe that even folks in Japan, school students in Japan have supported Congo Week. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, the why, that's a really good question. Really, we started it at the behest of Congolese people. A mentor of mine at the time was Congolese, and he played a key role in putting Congo in perspective, you know, for us, about its centrality to the future of the African continent and the future of the African world. So the founding members, Sister Carrie Crawford, a brother called Pumphrey, myself, we were clear that if we're going to invest our time, our resources, if there's one place on the planet that we're going to invest our time and our resources, where we figure it could exponentially advance the cause of Black liberation, it would be in the heart of the African continent, the heart of the motherland. So that was the rationale, you know, or part of the rationale for establishing Friends of the Congo at the behest of Congolese themselves. Over the years, my goodness, well, Congo Week is a space for global teaching. So we've certainly touched many communities, university campuses, such as the University of Maryland, was right there at the beginning of Congo Week, actually, in 2008. The African Student Association there, just yourself, you know, the Nuremberg Cultural Center has just been amazing in terms of supporting Congo Week. So from university campuses, the faith institutions, to communities, you know, just over 75 countries have participated, some 600 communities over the years. And probably the biggest impact, I can say, Brother Solomon, that we've had, which is really key, it meets the our mission. We have two overarching aims. One is to raise global consciousness about what's unfolding in the Congo. And we do that through a bunch of means, you know, interviews such as this, creating films, writing articles, working with museums, working with theater. We work with plays, museums, theaters, just every conceivable institution you can think of, we work with in order to raise consciousness. But the most important is providing support to local institutions, where we provide support to indigenous leaders deep in the rainforest, youth leaders who are building movements, to Pan-African movement, to bring about change in the Congo, connecting movement leaders here in the U.S. with movement leaders in the Congo. Recall when there was uprisings in Ferguson, which really doesn't, it's like a side issue, but really doesn't get enough credit for the role that it has played. Those brave young people in Ferguson, right, in spurring what would later be imposed on top of it as the Black Lives Matter movement. It really was the Ferguson movement, but in any case, that's a different story. So
just bringing
the youth in the Congo. I remember we brought the youth in the Congo to Ferguson, you know, to ground with our brothers and sisters in Ferguson, so they can see where really the cutting edge of resistance is in the United States. you know, to not only to build ties, but to learn from each other. So basically supporting those, the youth, the indigenous leaders, the artists, the cultural makers, the artists who are using their filmmaking, their music, their paintings, to advance a Pan-African agenda, the support that we provided for them and how they've utilized or leveraged that support in order to advance the Pan-African cause, not only in the Congo, but in different parts of Africa, because they've gone to Ghana and South Africa and elsewhere to build with other young people on the continent. So that that is probably the most concrete and fulfilling part of the work that we've done over the years in investing our time, resources, into a young generation of Congolese who are clear about bringing about change in the heart of the African continent, not only for the Congo itself, but for Africa as a whole.
Appreciate that. So to both of you, how do people get involved? Both of you are very much involved in the planning and organizing. How do people get involved? You know, I believe Congo Week starts, what, October 15th to the 21st of October, 2023. How do people get involved? Are there websites? And then, you know, what are tangible things that folks can do on the ground? If there's students or even staff watching right now at the University of Maryland, or you know, we know this is the World Wide Web, you know, so it might reach all the way to University of Los, you know, California, Los Angeles, UCLA. How do people, you know, get involved?
So the first thing they can do is go to congoweek.org. You'll see this. There we'll have a little breakdown of the week, also a calendar of events. Stay tuned to the events. And Brother Maurice, we have Wednesday, I believe we'll have a day of action. Mm-hmm. Correct.
Yes.
Yes. Wednesday will be a day of action. So please tune in to those events, which we'll get. We don't want to give it away now, but you know, so everybody, all your viewers, all your listeners, please go to congoweek.org, register for the events, and start there.
Yeah, and the way students and faculty can help be a part of Congo Week, in addition to what Kito just laid out, and going to the congoweek.org and signing up on the event calendar. They can share their registration information with campus organizations, where not only on their own campus, but on other campuses as well, to encourage students, the African Student Associations, those are part of the Black Cultural Centers, to come and sign up for one of the forums. I mean, we have forums on colonization, decolonization, forums on Lumumba. We'll be doing a special forum on Lumumba on Tuesday, October 17th. We have a special forums on resource exploitation, women, Pan-African movements in the Congo that's being led by women, just a whole range of topics that we'll be discussing. So professors can assign the students, give students extra credit for tuning into one of the forums that we have during Congo Week. So those are ways that that people can help to support Congo Week. One, reaching out to your campus organization and obviously your fellow students to sign up and register for a forum. Two, reaching out to your professors or the professors themselves, turning over their class to one of the forums where they give their students credit, or they can have their entire class tune in. We have University of Connecticut, Georgia State, Morehouse, Adelphi, a bunch of universities where the professors are going to bring their entire class to participate in the forums that we're having throughout the week from October 15th through the 21st. And then we'll have a wrap-up event on October 28th, Saturday, October 28th, where we're going to look at Congo Basin and its importance in combating the climate crisis and Congo overall and its centrality or its role in facilitating the green energy transition, that transition to electric vehicles. So there's just a tremendous amount of content that university campuses in particular can participate in and be a part of and supporting Congo Week.
I thank you. Thank you so much both of you for coming on today. And this won't be the last time because you know, this could be an entire 16-week course, you know, to talk about the significance of Congo and also how to you know actively get engaged and get involved with doing our part regardless of where you don't have to be in Congo right now. You don't have to be in Congo to get involved and to play a significant role. We all play a role, and many hands make light work. The more of us that get involved, the better. And
we offer internships too, Solomon. So if the students want to do an internship with us, they're definitely welcome to go to friendsofthecongo.org and sign up to volunteer and become an intern.
For an internship, do you have to be in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area? Or...
No, it could be anywhere. We have interns from high schools in New Jersey, wow, to universities in Lyon in France. So we have interns from all over the world. They come in virtually. They do research, they do studies, they write articles. There's a host of things that they do according to their interests and their expertise, and we facilitate that.
Oh, that's awesome. Okay, that's good. Yeah, I'll definitely be telling my students about that as well as the form. So I appreciate you both, Brother Kito. Thank you for joining us, and Brother Maurice Carney. Thank you as always. We look forward to getting involved. And as you know, you've talked to Dr. Ziegler, the director of the Burroughs Cultural Center. He's on board. We have long been supporters of Congo Week, and will continue to be supporters of Congo Week. This is, and this is a clarion call to all Black cultural centers out there. I mean, this should be part of our work. I mean, if you're a Black cultural center, you know, supporting Congo Week should be, you know, just something that we do mandatorily. I mean, it's a no brainer, as they say.
Yeah.
Thank you. So
thank you, Solomon.
Appreciate it. Thank you. So for Your World News and the Nibiru Media Collective, I'm Solomon. You've been listening to Brother Maurice Carney and Brother Kito talking about Congo Week and in the larger context, the history of Congo, a brief history of Congo. Is much more. That's why we're going to do more of these shows with these brothers, but also Congo Week and how you can get involved. Please find a way to get involved. Until next time, peace.